name is Wayde Goodall. I'm the Dean of the College of Ministry at Northwest University, and I want you to lift your hands straight up in the air. Straight up in the air. Turn them backwards. Bend down. Pat yourself on the back. Say, yay, children's workers. You are my favorite. My last church that I pastored before I came to the university is about 4,000 people, and I have more budget going into children's ministry than any other department in the church, you know, and I made some other pastors mad, but because I believe in you, and more than that, I believe in kids. So, how about you? That's true. So, we had three children's pastors. We pastored, my wife and I pastored inner city church, and it's a very interesting demographic in that city. And when we started, it was probably 1,000 people. It was a very suburban look, but it was an inner city church, and it looked weird. Didn't need to look like the suburbs in the middle of a city. Our city, the composition of it was 50% black and 50% everything else. And but in our church, we didn't have that many black that attended our church. I looked at the demographics of our city, and I said, wow, we are not reaching our city because the church is supposed to look like the city.
Yes, right.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
So the reason God puts you in your place where you are is he wants you to identify with the culture where you live. And so I believe that with all my heart. And so there's a really good reason why we were there in that city. And so I said, we got to reach this city. And so then I did some further research and I discovered that half of the population in our city, as I mentioned, were black, but 80% of the children and those in that particular group did not know who their father was, didn't have a father at home. So I had a dilemma. What do I do? How do I fix this? How do I reach the kids of our city? How can we look like our city? So I said to my pastors, I said, we're going to become father to the fatherless, and we're going after this city. And we're going to create an incredible Boy Scout, Girl Scout, Royal Ranger, Missionette, whatever you call it, kind of program in our church. And we're going after the children because we don't want them not to know the Lord, right? And we want them to be functional, not dysfunctional. Because Christianity is all about being healthy. God wants you healthy. God wants the people in your church healthy. God wants the children in your church healthy, and as you know, if you've been working with kids for very long, there's a lot of dysfunction, isn't there? Because kids come to your ministry, they come to your nursery, they come to your preschool, they come to whatever you've got going on, and they bring their baggage with them, don't they? And I know that it's very upsetting to you, it's very upsetting to me, but I have a lot of hope in my life because I believe God can fix anybody. How about you? And so you and your role, you play a very critical role. You are the handshake to the parents or the parent that's coming to your church. Many times you're the very person that's going to open a heart so they'll come to Christ and they'll never be the same. And if you've been doing children's work for very long, you know that you can impact a life. You can see a life dynamically change, can't you? Lots of times, though, when we're doing this kind of work with children, we can burn out because it can get exhausting, can it? My wife and I were involved in youth ministry for about 9 years, and we thought we'd be youth pastors all of our life, but the reason we quit is because we couldn't keep doing the all-nighters. You know? And so there's stuff that goes with whatever kind of a program you're with, but I don't want you to burn out. I don't want you to become exhausted. I want you to take care of you because the needs are great. And wherever you are, wherever you're serving, there are incredible needs where you are the answer. You can bring the answer offered in Jesus Christ. So if you don't take care of you, guess what? You can't take care of anyone else. Paul tells us when he writes to Timothy that when you're choosing an elder or a deacon in a church, a leader, they need to be able to take care of their own household, because if they can't take care of their own household, what are they doing in the ministry? And so the Bible tells us in Matthew 19:19 that we are to love our neighbor as what? Love ourselves. And so if you don't take care of you, it's really hard for you to take care of anyone else. And we have a lot of people that are involved in ministry, wonderful people just like you. that are involved in ministry, and you get exhausted, you get this thing called compassion fatigue. You care so much that it wears you out. Have any of you ever been there? You just care and care and care, and you get more and more tired because you lose your energy. So I'm going to talk to you about how to take care of yourself, how you can watch out for yourself, because if you don't watch out for yourself, you're going to, the ministry around you could fall apart. And if you've been around a little bit like I have, you understand that leaders do fall apart. Leaders can be dysfunctional because they're not watching themselves. And you are all leaders that God has called. You have an incredible calling on your life. And you're called to see young people change. You're called to bring hope to young people. And you're called to bring healing to families. In our church that I was talking about a moment ago, we had some rules in that church. And one, when I had three children's pastors in that size church, you know, the board and others wondered, why are you putting so much of our budget into that part? Because I said, well, we have a great need in our city. There's all kinds of kids that don't know who their dads are, and there's all kinds of things going on that, you know, we can fix. We've got the answer. Do you really believe you have the answer?
Yes.
You do. You're the best show in town. I mean, you've really got the answer for these people, no matter what's going on in their life. And I said, we need to invest in this. And so when we started investing in it, we got more staff and we provided more tools, like our nursery. On any given Sunday, we had about 100 babies in it. Now, how many of you are thinking about diapers right now? So a rule in our nursery was in that church is every baby is returned to their parent with a clean diaper. Wow. That was a rule. We sanitized all the toys every Saturday evening because Sunday's coming. Some of you can say with me, Sunday's coming.
Sunday's coming.
And you got to be ready for Sunday. And one of the greatest concerns of every parent when they drop their child off at your nursery is what? Is it sanitized? Or is my child going to get sick? Is it safe? Is there security there? And so we made sure that we knew what parents were worried about, and they didn't have to worry when their child was with us because we're going to take care of them. And that baby was going to come back clean. And so our nursery grew, and guess what happened then? You've got more young couples in your church or more single mothers in your church, which brings, by the way, more dysfunction. So dysfunction never goes away. In fact, it might even get more complicated, but you want all kinds of dysfunction in your church because that's what Jesus is all about, fixing dysfunctional lives, right? And so you're going to get busier, but you're going to learn how to train people and how to delegate and all that. I'm going to show you how to do that in just a moment. But we focused on that because that was important to us, and I want to encourage you in this room to keep focused on kids. Because, again, I don't know if there's a more important ministry that goes on in the church. Now, I want to talk to you about you, what's going on as leaders. For a few years, I was involved in a think tank that was studying you, and we're trying to figure out why so many of you quit, and why so many people don't want to do what you do and what I do. And so we had $8 million to spend studying those two questions. That's a lot of money, isn't it? So $8 million given to Duke University by the Lilly Foundation to study why Christian leaders quit their jobs or why so many people, young people, don't want to get involved in Christian leadership. And we discovered this after spending that money. We gave $1.5 million to the Mayo Clinic to study the health of you and me who are involved in leadership. And we spent the other $6.5 million by getting the best thinkers in the country, the best researchers we could find to study those questions. Why do you quit? Why do we lose people like you in church work? And why do so many people, I mean, do you have a hard time getting workers to help you?
Yeah.
It's a big deal, isn't it? But maybe there's some reasons why they don't want to help you. Maybe they're afraid to help you because they're afraid that it'll tear them apart. And so we looked at those kinds of questions and we discovered these answers. So many people don't want to do what we do because of these issues. Conflict and stress. Any of you have conflict in your life?
Yes.
You do. You want to talk about it? No, we can talk later. It looks like it could go on more than a minute, couldn't it? So all of us have conflict in our life, and we have stress. And a lot of times when we do church work, ministry types of stuff, we think, well, why do we have conflict in this kind of work? Seems like everybody ought to like us. We're just there to help them. And I remember when I started out in the ministry, I couldn't figure out why everybody didn't like me. I liked them. But I found out that, boy, I tell you what, it didn't take very long for people kind of to dislike you and let you know. You know, especially when you're working with their kids. And so you've got conflict issues going on, and you just need a heavy dose of Solomon's wisdom, don't you? And so conflict happens, and conflict builds stress in your life. And the number one reason why you quit and why other people don't want to do what you do is that right there, conflict and stress. So what do I tell myself about that? I like to know who my enemy is. I like to know what's going to get to me, because I don't know how I'm going to make it unless I know who my enemy is. I can't win a war until I know who my enemy is. And so if conflict and stress are my enemy, I need to know how to handle conflict. I need to know how to manage conflict. So what do you do if you have a child in your children's program, and a father comes in very angry, and he wants that child, he wants to take that child out of there, but you've never seen that father before? That's called conflict, and that's called stress. And so the single mother could have dropped that child off and, you know, said, don't let anybody else pick up this child except this. And he insists, he's yelling, he's in your face, and that's called conflict. What are you going to do? You're going to do the right thing. You're not going to let him have that child unless there's permission. And if you can't get, if you don't have permission for him and he insists, you call 911. Say 911.
911.
I mean, there are ways to get help really fast. I've called the police before as a pastor. You know, I've done those kind of things, or I've got a hold of the senior pastor right away, you know, because these things happen. Now, that's a pretty intense kind of a conflict thing I just described, but you have conflict all the time with children. Well, why didn't you change my baby's diaper this way? Or why didn't you have this kind of a program? Or why aren't you doing this or doing that? You know, these kind of things going on, and learning how to manage this in your life is really a good thing to know, because it's always going to be there. Conflict's been on earth ever since the beginning of time. In fact, it didn't start on earth, right? It started in heaven. Well, the devil disagreed with God, thought he was as good as God. So conflict, there's hundreds of references to conflict through the Bible. But what happens with conflict? It brings on stress. And so you've got that going on. And then you feel like, I don't need to do this. I'm not sleeping. I'm not taking care of myself. And I'm going to show you how to fix this in a minute. And then what happens, one of the reasons you quit or other people don't want to do what you do, is that it creates health challenges. In this think tank for Duke University, we discovered that because of conflict and stress, people that are in our role in leadership in the church, we're more unhealthy than the general population. I mean, we're more unhealthy than the drinkers, the doers, and the chewers. Because that gets to us, conflict and stress. And it can wear us out, and it wears our body out, and there's lots of things we do to try to, you know, get over, be healthy, but this is wearing us down. And so people finally say, you know what? I can go work at children at Walmart, you know, and have a ministry, you know, but this kind of stuff in the church is kind of crazy. But, you know, I want to encourage you that there are answers to all these issues around taking care of yourself. What did I say about loving your neighbor as what? You know, you're the most important person on earth. If you don't take care of you, how are you going to take care of them? Husbands are to love their wife like they love themselves, love themselves. And you, to minister to other people, you got to take care of you. You're important. Say, I'm important.
I'm important.
You are important. And you're critical. God's called you. And he wants you to take care of yourself. He doesn't want you burning out. He doesn't want you becoming overwhelmed. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy. Because when you're taking care of kids and you're doing all this, you're helping them come to the Lord, it's hard work. Some of the most difficult work that we do in the ministries around that. Then the third reason why people quit back here again is financial concerns. But what we discovered there when we were doing the study on all of us involved in leadership is financial concerns are way down the ladder. Most of us in this room either do it bivocationally or we do it for free. Some of us get to do it full time. Why do we do it for free or bivocationally? Because we care and God has a calling on our life. Do you sense God's calling on your life?
Yeah.
And so money, I mean, it's nice when you have money, but you got to have it to exist. But that isn't why we do what we do. Let me show you some other things here. About 35% of all pastors are voted out or fired in their lifetime. So that's a lot of people. And about half of those people that are voted out or fired never go back. So if you get fired from a ministry kind of a thing, or voted out by a board or something like that, that kind of a decision happens. Might have to go back. And we found the reason they don't go back is because you love too much. And you say, you know, it's almost like you break up with someone you're in love with and you say, I'm never going to love again because it hurts too much. So people, a lot of times, they don't go back after they've gone through one of these negative experiences. They say, you know, I'm not going to take a risk again. But I want to tell you, take the risk. If that's ever happened to you, don't worry about it. Just get up, dust yourself off, and get going at it again. I've gone through an experience like that in my life, and you know what? I had a pity party, but I got over the pity party really fast. You know, you can have a pity party, you just don't stay very long. Get up and get going again. And most quit within the first 5 years of ministry. So a lot of people doing what we do in this room, we quit within the first 5 years because we discover, boy, this is hard. This isn't what I thought it was going to be, and it's kind of tough here. 85% of American churches in the U.S. have less than 90 people. That means the people in this room, most of us, the majority of us, are bivocational or we're not getting paid for what we're doing. Most pastors in America, over 50% of them, there's 350,000 churches, give or take a few, are bivocational. And conflict issues are the number one reason why we quit. That make sense? Any of you disagree? Let me move on. What do you do with that? I wanted to paint the bad side of the picture because I like to know the bad side because it tells me what to do for the good side. I've gone through a lot of these issues in my own life. And I felt like quitting a lot of times. And somebody asked me once, how often do you ever feel like quitting? I said, sure. I said, how often do you feel like quitting? I said, about 25 times a year, about every other Monday. You're wiped out after Sunday. And you wonder, what happened on Sunday? How come it didn't work the way I thought it was going to work? Because, you know, it just doesn't. I mean, it's kind of unpredictable what we do. I mean, it's hard to measure it. But we just keep doing what we do because God's called us to it. We give it our best shot. That's why conferences like this are so important because we can give it our very best effort. We can learn new tools to put in our toolbox to help us reach kids. Let me show you some things that you can do for yourself in the next 20 minutes here. Because this is about you. I want you to take care of you. I want you to watch your life, watch over you, and guard you because I don't want any of you burning out. I want you to last until you're 95. Can you do that? Or as long as God gives you breath. Number one, you got to know who you are. Who are you? Oftentimes I ask people that question, who are you? Tell me about you. Who are you? What? And they sometimes, you know, if you ask a guy who he is, he tells you what he drives or where he works. Who are you? Well, I drive a Chevy. You know, or I work at Boeing. You know, and if you ask a lady who she is, she tells you how she feels. And you know, who are you? Well, I feel great. I didn't ask you that. You know, who are you? So do you know who you are? Do you know the calling of God on your life? It took me quite a while to figure that out for my own life because I didn't grow up in a Christian home. The first time I ever heard the name of Jesus in my life was when I was 21 years old. And a missionary led me to Christ when I was in the Navy stationed overseas, and I didn't know who I was. I was very confused about who I was. But as I started reading the Word and living in the Word and listening to great preachers and going to churches like your churches, I start understanding who I was, why God created me to be the person that I am. I understood and appreciated the personality I have. And before I was a Christian, I was like an extrovert. I was the life of the party. I'd just get drunk and I'd be the life of the party. But really, my personality type, I'm a social introvert. I like being quiet. I'd rather be listened than talk. And here I am that God always puts me in the talking business. And what, you know, just makes me have to trust God. But I really don't mind when I go to a party sitting in a corner with a good book. I'd rather listen to you than talk to you about what I think might be good for me to say. And so that's my personality type. And there are different personality types that God uses. I mean, Jacob was a quiet man. Esau was what? A wild hunter. Introvert, extrovert. A lot of leaders around the world are social introverts because they think and they contemplate things. And sometimes you might feel bad about who you are, but you need to understand that God created you the way you are. He gave you your DNA. He gave you your personality. Now, what grows throughout your life is character, but your personality stays the same. We grow deeper in the Lord, our character becomes more and more Christ-like. Some of us really become characters. You know, we grow in our character, but your personality is you. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Who are you? Where do you get your answers about who you are? Because when you know who you are, you'll know what you're supposed to do. And so Jesus spoke again to the people. He said, I am the light of the world. And John, that's where all the I am passages are used. And he kept saying, I am, I am, I am. So when someone asks you who you are, you look at yourself in the mirror and say, who are you? You can say, I am. So who are you? Know who you are. If you haven't yet discovered who you are, I just want to give you a clue. God thinks you're absolutely incredible. He thinks you're wonderful. He's gifted you. You have a DNA. Not only are you created in the image of God, but John chapter 1, verse 12 tells us that you are a child of God. Not just created in the image of God, you are a child of God. God is your dad. Who are you? So, know who you are. And how you know that is you got to know whose you are. So when I came to Christ, I discovered a lot of things. I grew up in a very angry home, very dysfunctional home, very angry father, a lot of rage, a lot of cussing, a lot of swearing, a lot of just junk going on. And I didn't like the word father for years because I thought, boy, if my heavenly father's like my earthly father, I'm in trouble. I thought God stood around every corner just wanting to thump me. Because I couldn't get everything perfect, but our Heavenly Father isn't like that. He's merciful and He's kind and He's gracious. And by the way, when you understand that about you, you'll communicate that to the children you work with because a lot of them feel very down on who they are. They don't know who they are. A lot of the parents don't know who they are. And so when you can show them you and how content you are with who you are in Christ, and He's provided all the answers for you, guess what? It's going to help you with them. And that's what you want to do, isn't it? Now, the second thing you got to understand about who you are is these are just, I mean, we could go on and list like 1,000 of these. There's over 6,000 promises in the Bible about who you are, and I've just listed 5 of them here, but say these words with me. I am a child of God.
I am put on earth not by accident, but for a reason.
I am deeply loved by God.
I am accepted by God.
And God has a plan for my life. That feel good? I hope it makes you feel good because that's who you are. And you can go all the way through the Bible and keep writing down what God says about you. Because you're incredible. And God has His hand on your life. And some of you have gone through tremendous pain in your life. Some of you might have been hurt, wounded, molested, rejected. But let me tell you this. If you don't deal with your past will always deal with you. Let God heal your pain. Let God heal your heartache. Let God heal whatever happened to you that brought pain into your life. Because He wants to heal you. And then He'll give you
compassion, because you will understand the compassionate God, and He'll help you help other people that go through the same thing that you're going to have gone through, right? So, very quickly here, this is a little bit about who you are, but there's so much more the Bible says. The second thing that the Bible teaches is about handling stress and knowing who we are is know whom you're trying to please. So who are you trying to please? Right. You're trying to please God. So how are you going to please God the best? John 5:30 says that by myself I can do nothing. So I can't do this without the Lord. I can't do what God's asked me to do. And I've always had that wonderment whenever the Lord opens a new door for me or I write a book or something like that. I'm thinking, boy, God, do you know what you're doing? This is old Wayde here. Just old Wayde. And so, but by myself, I realize I can't do anything and neither can you. We need His help every time we're with these students. Every time we're with these kids, because you have no idea what they're going to bring into the room. Some days you'll need absolute, incredible, divine wisdom because you'll not know how to respond. You'll not know what to do. And you have to have God's help in your life. And so, who are you trying to please? You want to please God, because there'll be times when you're being pushed into a corner by this parent or that parent or this kind of a situation or that situation, and your whole goal is understanding that you serve an audience of one. You're trying to please God. You show up early, you stay late. You do the extra effort. You go the extra mile because you're working for God. God's signing your paycheck. God's called you to do this, and you can trust Him. There's been different times in our life where we've walked away from a situation we didn't know what we're going to do. And so my wife and I will look at each other and we'll just say, we're just going to trust God. And you know what? He's never let us down. You can trust God to help you no matter what. So you give it your best effort. Do your best and trust God with the rest. But trust Him, because that's who you're trying to please. Mark 1:11 said, you're my son whom I love. With you I am well pleased. So God's pleased with your effort. And some days, your effort isn't 100%, is it? Sometimes we get down on ourselves because we have a cold or we're tired and we just can't give it everything that we want to give it. But give it 100% of your 80%. We all have stuff going on in our life. There's all issues, and some days you might not feel like you're just going to knock it out of the park. But give it your best effort anyway. And God will bless you. There's been many times when I've given a sermon where I said to myself, that was absolutely horrible. I looked at my wife and I said, they will never, ever want to hear me again. And but yet, people have come up to me sometimes after those kinds of feelings saying, you know what, I don't know what it was, Pastor Goodall, that changed my life. You know, and I just learned to say, you know what, I don't know how these things work, but I trust God. And I know who I'm trying to please, and I'm going to give it my very best effort. When I started out in ministry, you know a little bit about my story, but I didn't know Jesus. But my testimony was something that a lot of churches wanted to hear. A lot of like teen challenge kind of churches. And so the first church I was ever speaking in was a church in Southern California named Cardiff by the Sea. It was a beautiful place that just north of San Diego, south of Orange County, Cardiff by the Sea. So I went there, and it was on a Sunday night. And so they, I don't know what they did for promo, but everybody was in the building. The building only sat like 150 people, but it was packed. So I walked in there, I sat down in the front pew. I'd never spoken before in front of a congregation. I'm sitting there and I'm having an anxiety attack. In fact, I was having an anxiety attack for about a week before the event. I didn't want to go. I was sick to my stomach. I couldn't eat. I couldn't sleep. I was a nervous wreck. So I sat down at that service. The worship band's going on. I'm sitting there having an anxiety attack. I know I'm going to be introduced any time. So I stood up and I ran out of the building. I did. I just split. I ran out of the building, and I remember leaving that building out the back door, slamming through that back door, running across the parking lot. There was this big field across the street from this church. And I ran into the middle of the field, and I said, God, this is not fair. This is killing me. And I said, you either have to heal me or change my occupation. And I think I heard the voice of God. And I think he said, why are you worried about you? Let me worry about you. You just do what I'm telling you to do. Just do your thing because I've asked you to do it. And you might not get an A. But who cares? You got my heart. And so a lot of times we worry about that kind of stuff. And I learned a very valuable lesson. If people don't like me, they won't show up. But it's not my fault. I'm going to give it my best effort. I'm going to try my hardest. I'm going to please God. Because that's what it's all about. But when I do that, let me tell you what. When I realize God's signing my paycheck, I do show up early, stay late. I'm working harder than anybody else because I want to please God. So people that understand that, they're going for it. They're not lazy. They're not sleeping in. You know, they're getting it done. They're thinking of all kinds of ideas on how to do this better. So know who you're trying to please. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. All these things will be added unto you. So seek Him. Try to please Him. So what's the right thing to do? If it pleases God, that's the right thing to do. Lots of times, we can't measure what we do, as I mentioned. And lots of times, we don't know the perfect strategy. We come to these kind of events because we want to get new tools to learn how to do what we're going to do or what God's called us to do. But so oftentimes I ask myself, what's the right thing to do here? What's the accurate thing to say? The Bible tells us the steps of the righteous will be ordered by the Lord, that my integrity will guide my steps. So that tells me, do the right thing, Wayde. Even when it's hard, do the right thing. Even when people disagree with you, do the right thing. Be honest, be gracious, but do the right thing. So we're trying to please God in everything we do. And if you know who you are, and if you know who you're trying to please, that's going to help you a whole lot. It helps me. Know what you are trying to accomplish is number three. So I ask myself this question a lot. What am I trying to accomplish? What am I trying to do here? I happen to be a dean at a university, but what is it just a job to me? No, I have a goal. Really, I do. Sometimes I don't tell people my goals because they'll think I'm having a vision of grandeur. They'll think I'm crazy. How can you? But I do. I have a dream. I have a goal. When I pastor a church, I have a dream. I have a goal. And I knew how I was going to try to accomplish it. God will help you connect the dots. But if we don't take time to listen to God and write down, what's your plan, God? What can I do? Then we're not going to, we don't know what we're trying to accomplish. And lots of times we're shooting in the dark. But God gives you a target. It's called a vision. He tells you what to do. I had this vision in this city where we pastored to reach these kids that didn't have dads. And you know what happened? We became the fastest growing black church in that region of the country. Because we're reaching the kids and we're reaching their parents, single parent most of the time. Then I had all these single mothers coming to the church and all these kids coming to the church. And then now all these single dudes are showing up looking at all the single ladies. So that created another problem for me. So I said to the single dudes who were eyeing all of our ladies in the church, you got to go through me to get to them, dude. And I used to box. I'm their daddy. You got to get permission to date one of our ladies in this church. Boy, I tell you what, those ladies were very happy about that because a lot of guys they couldn't trust. So take me out if you want to get to them because I don't care. I'll just go to heaven. But anyway, don't go there. But, you know what you're trying to accomplish. What's your goal? So I have these days on my schedule. I try to fast the first 21 days of every year. I've done that for years. It's called a Daniel fast. I don't go to a total fast, but I fast for 3 weeks, and what I try to do, most years I can do it, some years I haven't been able to do it. First week I fast for me, and I ask the Lord, what's wrong with me? How can I fix me? Second week I pray about my family, my wife and kids. Third week I pray about my ministry, and God gives me goals of what I'm trying to accomplish. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So, what are you trying to accomplish? Number four, have a sense of timing. You can't do everything today. Takes time. Ministry takes time. One of the first sermons I ever preached as an associate pastor in this big church, I got up and I spoke and spoke and spoke, and the pastor said to me after the sermon, "Wayde, you know, you don't need to tell everybody about all of God in one sermon. Take your time, precept upon precept, event upon event. Do vacation Bible school this year if you haven't been able to do it. Don't try to do three. Don't try to do it next week. Don't try to do everything at once. There's a sense of timing. And at daybreak, timing for me, it's all around this. I get up early in the morning. I try to pray every morning. Timing. I get alone to pray when I'm stressed out. Understand the benefit of delegation. Our time's running short, and we could talk about this all day long, but our job as leaders is to equip other people to do our work. So we're trying to work our way out of a job. And you might think, if I work my way out of a job, I won't have a job. Not true. You'll always have a job. So we don't delegate because we're perfectionists sometimes, or we're insecure, or we have time management issues, but we got to delegate and got to believe in people. I believe in people. I trust every one of you. I get to know you, but I believe in you. We got to believe in people. We do our homework. We do our checks and all of that stuff. We do all of our security stuff, but we believe in people, and people are just like you. You've been insecure. You didn't think you could do it one time, but, right? And if somebody didn't give you a chance, where would you be? Someone gave me a chance. You give other people a chance. Delegate and trust them. They might not do it just like you do it, but they're going to do it, and they'll grow. And make prayer a practice. We got to pray. This is spiritual business. This isn't political. There's all kinds of dynamics going on here in what we do. And there's an enemy that wants to destroy kids. We could list statistics all day long on how the enemy hates kids, because kids have so much potential. The Bible tells us this in Proverbs. The enemy is out to destroy the precious one. Who's the precious one? Those children. And so we got to pray. We need God's wisdom. We need His discernment. So prayer, by the way, is a huge stress reliever. It helps you release anxiety. Be still and know that I am God, the Bible tells us. Number 7, find your healthy balance between work and relaxation. Have fun. Can you say the word fun? Fun's good. My wife has the ministry of fun. I have the ministry of intensity. And so she just creates fun. But you got to have fun. Have a good time and joke around and create fun times on your calendar. God's provided all things richly for our enjoyment. And number 8, whatever you're stressing out with, whoever it is, whatever their name is in your church or the child you're worried about, the issue that's going on, can you just give it to the Lord? Give that person to the Lord. Name them. Name the situation. Say, "Jesus, I give you this person. I give you this situation." I have done that so many times. I've asked God to remove people from the church, and He's done it. I didn't say a word. You know, I've asked people to be drawn to the church. He's done it. I pray about all that stuff. And any specific stress that comes up, God wants it. This isn't supposed to be heavy and wearing us out. That helpful to you? Yes. We're out of time, and you've been so nice to listen to me, and it's been fun to be here. I wish I could just spend all day with you. We're out of time. Jesus is our stress reliever. He's the one who will help you manage the pressures of life, and He wants to give you peace in what you do. So take care of you. Will you do that? Lift your right hand. Say, "I will."
I will.
Take care.
Take care.
Of me.